It's dark as a dungeon and damp as the dew, where the danger is double and the pleasures are few, where the rain never falls and the sun never shines. It's dark as a dungeon way down in the mine.
Russell Trall Neville was born in Iowa in 1878. The son of two former Burns Township residents who then moved their family back to Illinois in the early 1880s, settling in Kewanee. Founded in 1854, Kewanee had reached over 2,000 in population by the early 1870s. By the time the Nevilles returned to Kewanee, the population had grown to nearly 3,000. And by the time young Russell Neville graduated from high school at the end of the 19th century, the city was the economic engine of Henry County, boasting a population of over 8,000. Neville developed an early love of adventure and science. He raced bicycles in and around Kewanee. He also earned a reputation as a daring stunt rider, once riding a race against the clock while pedaling backward. During his first year at the University of Illinois, he was a competitive walker. He also was a coin collector, and he ran ads seeking to buy and sell coins. Neville read various nature and science magazines and often ran ads seeking a variety of items such as meteorites, shells, and Native American relics. He also sought frogs, snakes, and lizards, but no toads. Neville, however, fell in love with photography. As a young boy, he built a camera from scratch. Neville also worked as a viewman in his teens, going from town to town selling photos to anyone who would buy them. His passion led him to take many photos of a wide variety of people and other subjects, winning awards along the way. Neville graduated from Kewanee High School in 1898. He then attended the University of Illinois, studying natural science. But Neville stayed at the university for only 1 year. He returned to Kewanee, where he lived for the rest of his life. He was a view photographer, and he taught amateurs in photography as well. And he took baby pictures. Simply, Neville tried hard to make a living through his art.
You know the year of 1900.
In the late summer of 1900, a hurricane devastated Galveston, then the fourth largest Texas city. It destroyed 2,636 houses and left thousands more damaged. Although its death toll will never be known precisely, the storm claimed upwards of 8,000 lives on Galveston Island and several thousand more on the mainland. It is still considered the nation's deadliest natural disaster. Neville contacted Leslie's Weekly, a national photography journal, about covering the storm. He then made his way to New Orleans and he took the first relief boat to Galveston Island. He took photos of the flood for nearly a day before he joined relief workers in search of bodies. Then life's trajectory changed. In 1903, Neville married Kewanee native Mamie Irene Ronstrom. Soon, Neville gave up trying to make a living in photography. Neville became the assistant secretary of the Kewanee Building and Loan while working as an insurance agent for a number of carriers and also serving as a justice of the peace. In 1907, Mamie gave birth to the couple's only child, Julia Dorothy Neville. Julia thrived in Kewanee, eventually graduating from Kewanee High School in 1925. At some point, Neville decided to pursue the practice of law. He read law and worked in the law office of esteemed Kewanee attorney Charles K. Ladd. After Ladd's death, Neville moved to the law office of Blish and Lawson. Although having never attended law school, Neville nevertheless was admitted to the Illinois bar in 1912. The Neville family traveled on vacations, and soon Julia reached adulthood. But Neville never gave up photography. It remained his passion. He took photographs in and around Kewanee, mostly for himself, but often on behalf of the local newspaper, as well as other organizations. Neville also took photographs everywhere he went, and he continued to win recognition for his work. But Neville had grown up with a fascination with caves. He saw photos of Mammoth Cave when he was a small boy sitting on his father's lap. In high school, he attended a lecture on caves, which further whetted his appetite for caves. His work as a view photographer took him to some caves around Hopkinsville, Kentucky. In one, he and his 13-year-old guide lost their way and had to spend a night in a cave. Neville subsequently married his love of photography with his love of caving. Beginning in the early 1920s, Neville became one of the first amateur cave photographers. He was busy making motion pictures and taking superb still photographs in many of the notable caves in this country. By 1933, he had traveled over 2,000 miles underground through over 175 caves. Over those years, Neville gave hundreds of lectures on his adventures and appeared on numerous radio shows describing his exploits. One thing that made Neville's motion pictures particularly interesting was the fact that no portable electric lights were available. So he had to use magnesium flares, which were very expensive and could be dangerous. The flares were made especially for him. They were 72,000 candle power and burned for approximately 30 seconds. It's dark as a dungeon. Mammoth Cave, the longest cave in the world, and the surrounding area in south central Kentucky, was a popular vacation destination in the early part of the 20th century. Some of the first of America's tourist attractions included Mammoth Cave and other caves in the area, such as the New Entrance to Mammoth Cave, Great Onyx Cave, Great Crystal Cave, Diamond Caverns, Mammoth Onyx Cave, and Hidden River Cave. Two of Neville's cousins had visited Mammoth Cave in Kentucky in 1915, as did Neville himself a little later. When there, he took many cave photographs, one of which was used by a Kentucky railroad in advertising matter. Neville fell in love with the Kentucky caves. He soon planned his summer vacations to travel to those caves, to explore them and to photograph them. His adventurous sister, Hazel, and his adventurous daughter, Julia, joined him for these magnificent road trips. In 1922, Neville returned to Mammoth Cave, where Julia and later Hazel toured, explored, and photographed those caves and others over the next two decades. Getting to the caves was an adventure in itself. In 1924, Neville, Julia, and Hazel met William Floyd Collins. Born in 1887, Collins was one of the most well-known cave explorers of the Mammoth Cave region. Collins was obsessive about caves and spent most of his free time caving. A cautious private person, Collins nevertheless came to trust Neville, and they became friends. Over the next year, they spent considerable time together, accessing areas of the region's caves never previously penetrated. The Nevilles were the only outsiders to ever go caving with Floyd. Of course, Neville captured many of the moments in photographs as well as in motion pictures. But tragedy struck the next year. Collins was exploring a new area of a cave in late January 1925. He became trapped in a tight passageway when a 27-pound rock dislodged and pinned his foot. Unable to reach the rock in the tight space to remove it, Collins eventually died in the cave.
Floyd Collins was another great dramatic story. Collins had been trapped in a Kentucky cave by a falling boulder, and the whole nation wanted to know from hour to hour what progress his rescuers were making. The youth had been exploring the narrow, twisting entrance to the cave when the rock had fallen and pinned his foot so he couldn't move. The rescuers planned to sink a shaft to intercept the tunnel at the point where Collins was trapped. But before they could finish it, Collins died after 18 days in the tunnel. The nation felt a genuine sense of frustration and defeat.
Come all you young people and listen while I tell the fate of Floyd Collins, the lad we all knew well. His face was fair and handsome, his heart was true and brave. His body now lies sleeping in a lonely sandstone cave.
After Collins' death, the Neville family visited the area and the Collins family in July and again the following year. While the cave in which Collins died was not open to the public, the owner allowed Neville to go down the shaft to view the place where his good friend had died. Neville said it was one of the most dangerous things he ever did. Many of Neville's photographs of the cave in which Collins died and of the surrounding area circulated widely across the nation and around the world. Here's a 1925 photo of Neville holding Collins' lantern and cave owner B. Doyle holding the 27-pound rock which trapped Collins. Neville photographed Doyle at the exact spot where Collins was trapped. Plank and timbers used to try to reach Collins and from where Neville set off the flash for this photograph gave way 2 weeks later. Here's a July 1925 photo of Neville coming out of the rescue shaft that was dug to bring out Collins' body. The Collins and Neville families met after Collins' death. Here's a 1926 photo of the Neville party. Those and other photographs, like this one of Collins' tombstone, catapulted Neville to the forefront of caving photographers. His photographs were recognized as the best of their kind in existence, as written in the book Early Photography at Mammoth Cave. Here are some of the photographs and movies from Neville's Mammoth Cave explorations. This is the new entrance, which was a different cave operation showing a different part of Mammoth Cave. Here's part of the Neville expedition on the Crystal River, 400 feet underground in Crystal Cave. These are the remains called Little Alice, discovered in Salt's Cave and photographed by Neville, although they were displayed at the new entrance cave. Neville, Julia, and Hazel traveled all over the United States, with Neville taking thousands upon thousands of photographs. Neville also took several thousand feet of motion picture film. Lee Collins was the father of Floyd Collins. On the left is Fairy's Retreat in Dossie's Domes Cave. On the right, the waterfall in Higginbotham's Cave. Sheets of onyx and weird draperies in Beckner's Cave. The banana stalk was Neville's favorite formation. In 1927, Neville led an expedition into the Old Salt's Cave. The expedition consisted of 11 cavers. They entered the cave on the morning of July 11 at 11 a.m. They exited the cave the following Wednesday afternoon at 2:15 p.m. The group spent a total of 51 hours and 35 minutes underground, exploring the reaches of the cave. The Nevilles stayed at the New Entrance Hotel before their expedition into Old Salt's Cave. The hotel staff prepared the food for the cavers to take with them. Andy Collins lived in Kewanee with his family around the time of Floyd Collins' death. Andy did not go on the Salt's Cave trip, so his brother Homer went in his place. On the right, Neville photographed George Jackson's arrival for the Salt's trip. Julia's on the right. We'll be right back. Neville did more than just caving and photographing caves. He was one of the first aerial photographers, soaring above Kewanee with one of Kewanee's early pilots, Fred McChesney. To achieve his photographs, Neville stood up in the front seat of the biplane, turned around, and leaned outside the body of the craft, bracing his right shoulder against the wing strut, or rather, holding the strut clasped between his shoulder and face. Neville had to construct his own aerial camera to withstand the wind and vibrations of the plane. Once, the plane he was in plummeted to earth and crashed, leaving him suspended upside down from the so-called life belt. In his droll response to the episode, Neville said, "I found an ear of corn in my pocket, and I now claim to be the only person who ever picked corn from an airplane." Neville also wrote copiously about his daring photography exploits, and he was published in various newspapers and magazines. Neville was also a longtime amateur magician, entertaining friends and family with a wide range of sleights of hand and magic tricks. Neville even corresponded with the great Houdini about his art. Neville's pursuits and skills seemed endless. After visiting 150 or more caves and traveling over 1,000 miles through them, Neville began giving talks, followed by a showing of many of his photographs. Neville became known as the Caveman, and he gave his lecture called In the Cellars of the World 2,600 times, according to his obituary in the New York Times. Neville took many non-cave photos as well, which won awards and garnered him additional fame both in and outside of Kewanee. Russell Trall Neville died unexpectedly in 1950. He left a legacy of which our hometown should be proud. Let me through.